welcome to a satsang. You're going to hear in the background digging hammers. There you go. So all around us there's different types of construction going on, which is exactly what takes place in the world, right? You can't expect that you're going to just have ideal conditions here at all times for your meditation, for your satsang, for your inquiry. It doesn't happen that way. So all sorts of interruptions will take place, distractions, noises, etc. You just simply have to do it anyway. Have to make time and put in the efforts. There's no substitute for effort, no substitute for momentum. Every day you have to seize the moment, seize the day, and push it forward, which is what we've been doing. And in the recent videos, all videos, but recently, especially that we're getting looking at something we haven't looked at before, which is the purpose of satsang. The purpose of satsang is to look at you what you haven't looked at before, to encourage you to look further. Because that's in the looking, it comes the seeing. And in the seeing becomes the clarity, and in the clarity becomes the obviousness. And the obviousness becomes the dissipation of fear, and in the dissipation of fear brings the courage, and the courage brings the choice, and the choice brings the freedom, and the freedom brings the translation back into reality. Okay? Freedom brings the vision of the real world, and the real world is easily translated back into reality for us. So it's a positive cycle of looking at what you haven't looked at before. That's the whole point of it. So of course when we're looking at something, we're going to be surprised, maybe, or wondering, like, why are we looking at that, et cetera, et cetera. And you just have some faith that what we're talking about is extremely relevant, and the looking at it is extremely important, because it is. Otherwise, we wouldn't be doing this. The belief in transformation, the previous video, the essential essence of satsang points out that the hope and belief in transformation is the central key belief that we have. Right now somebody is transforming their yard by breaking up concrete. You see, they're going to lay something else down. Looking at transformation carefully, you know, just saves enormous misery and suffering. If you have the willingness to put in a little effort for an hour or two, you'll end up saving yourselves thousands and thousands of years of suffering just by doing that, by looking at what you've been unwilling to look at before, because you feel it's so important. You keep it in the dark, you know, like you keep it in some deep dark dungeon all surrounded by defenses and stuff, so you won't go look at it, thinking that if you look at it you might lose some belief in it or some hope in it, etc. But what we find out in satsang is that it's not like that. In looking at it again, we see it, and then we clarify it, and the fear dissipates, and we say, aha, I need that to continue on with existence, but I don't need to continue on with existence. Existence does need defenses. See, so our purpose is not to free existence up from defenses. No, it's to choose a different scenario, a problem-free scenario, an invulnerable scenario, eternal scenario, an unconditional love scenario, the real world. The real world. Choose the real world instead of existence. So existence requires enormous defenses. Well, always required. So it's not our purpose to strip the defenses away of existence and have us continue to dwell in existence. That's not the point of it at all. That would be cruel. Our purpose is going on the knowing that behind the dream is simply like a superimposition of forgetfulness upon what is. What is remains, even though we're dreaming that we've forgotten it. So dreams of forgetfulness don't get rid of what is being forgotten. It's still there. So eternity, reality, perfection, flawlessness, perfect freedom from fear, from vulnerability, from confusion. All of that is still present. We're just in a dream of forgetfulness. And that dream of forgetfulness has all sorts of defenses to make it seem viable, that one day it will succeed. So it seems to have a goal, seems to have a mission, seems to have a purpose. All of that is our defenses that simply keep us believing in it. And so it keeps the forgetfulness going. The ultimate goal, the real purpose of existence is to reach a point of complete forgetfulness, complete loss, destruction of reality, and replacement of reality with ourselves as prime creators. That's the ultimate purpose. And since we cannot attain that, we turn it into a future goal and have all these defenses needed to keep us believing we're going in that direction and keep us believing all the suffering and misery we're undergoing is beneficial and will pay off in the end. Keep us believing we can transform existence into some wonderful place, the kingdom of heaven, you know, on earth. That's all defenses. It's all defending the idea we had of trying to turn ourselves into prime creators. In other words, change what we are, which is the prime creation, and change us into the prime creator. In other words, it's trying to transform effects into cause. And that cannot be done. That's completely contrary to the laws of reality. But we, in order to entertain this idea, we have to believe it can be accomplished. Otherwise, we would, the misery and the suffering and the whole thing would be seen as just a ghastly nightmare, and we just set it down immediately. So we have to have all these defenses. And the key one is the defense of a belief in transformation is really the ultimate defense, that we can transform this world, transform this dream of loss, transform this dream of sickness, suffering, death, impermanence, change, loss, confusion, terror, despair, futility, impossibility, transform that into exactly what we want, what we really want. Of course, what we really want is reality. The dream is opposite of reality, complete opposite. So we believe that we can somehow transform this dream into exactly what we want. Why do we need to transform the dream into exactly what we want when reality is exactly what we want and it's right there for us every moment? Why not just accept reality the way it is? That's exactly what we want. And yet we're trying to transform this dream into exactly what we want. Okay, the key is that exactly what we want right now includes being prime creator. So we won't, as long as we hold on to that, you see, then existence has to be the means by which we think we can attain that. Because in reality, there is no mechanism for us changing what we are, transforming ourselves into being prime creator. There is no such mechanism, no laws, no rules which would allow that at all. So when we say we want exactly what we want, we mean we want to have all the benefits of reality, but also include that we're prime creator. Okay, and since we can't attain that, it's totally contradictory to the laws of reality, etc. We have to believe that existence is reality, this dream is reality, and that we are in a process of attaining it, process of attainment. In other words, we're in a process of transformation. Somehow, a fundamental transformation will take place, and we'll have everything that we want. We'll have invulnerability, eternalness, eternal nature. Everything will be exactly the way we want it, and plus we'll be prime creators. We'll be the prime creator of a new reality, of true reality, we think. So this belief then keeps us going, keeps us buying into existence, and blinds us to the nature of existence, the futility of it. Because if we believe in transformation, then we don't care what the problems are, do we? We don't care if someone says, well, it's impossible. We'll simply say, well, we'll simply transform that impossibility into the possible. If we say it's futile, they say we'll transform the futility. So the belief in transformation is the engine that drives our attachment to delusion. because we can simply fall back on that no matter what arises. We simply say, well, eventually we'll be able to transform that. For instance, you know, all the death that's taken place in the world, horrible, right? All these bodies dying, 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 loss, loss, loss. We simply come up with an idea like, oh, that's okay. We'll simply cause all the dead bodies to arise out of the grave and be given new life. You know, transform. The dead will be transformed. Not only will the living be transformed, the dead will be all transformed too. This is an ancient idea. I don't know who had it, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the resurrection of the dead. That's a belief in transformation that enables us to cope with the horrible loss that we continuously suffer in existence. We lose every friend, we lose every loved one, we lose every situation, everyone dies, all bodies die, turn to dust. And the way, instead of looking at that and saying, this is what existence is, it's loss. I don't want that. It's not giving me what I want. It will never give me what I want. Instead of accepting that and then choosing to remember reality, which is salvation, which is what God's laws entitle us to, instead of doing that, no, we claim, no, all this loss will be restored to us. All the dead will be resurrected, will come out of the grave and be resurrected, and all the loss that we've ever experienced will be restored to us. We cling to that absurd notion of transformation. Total, you know, defensiveness that we've simply invented. These are just rules and laws and we've invented. The idea that all the bodies that have ever died will somehow be reconstituted, come out of the graves, and be returned to us is a rule, it's a law, it's a belief that we've just made up. Because it enables us to continue on with existence, not tasting the complete bitterness of it by thinking, well, it's super bitter, but the sweetness, a sweetness, will be transformed into sweetness at some point. And so we're able to believe we can have everything we want, plus we'll be prime creators as well. But I'll tell you this, the bitterness that we're tasting existence, that's the only taste existence has. There is no other. It will never be transformed into sweetness. There's this plausible belief that it's coming. And every generation that believes in this transformation, they always say it's coming real soon. Real soon. Otherwise, people might say, hey, wow, this bitterness has been going on too long, you know, and I don't think it's ever going to get away, so I want to turn to inquiry and satsang and truth and remember what I really am and stop this ridiculous charade of trying to forget what I am, so just so that I can believe that I can be something other, be prime creator. Otherwise we would start to wake up, wouldn't we? Instead, we've been following all these teachings that tell us that this bitterness is going to be transformed, that the dead will arise from the grave, that we'll all be transformed, etc., etc. Each generation has some form of belief in transformation. It's gone on and on and on and on and on. And that just strings us along. There will be changes. There's always changes in existence. Reformatting, changing the frame around the picture. The picture is the picture of loss, and that picture never changes. But the framing around it keeps changing, and we keep looking at the frame thinking that there's, you know, these. If we just get the right frame around the picture will be transformed. That is not true, because effects cannot leave their cause. Effects and cause serve one purpose. They're united in the purpose they share. It's impossible for effects to share a different purpose than the cause gave those effects. Impossible. And we just keep believing in the impossible, that we can accomplish the impossible. Therein lies our complete arrogance. And therein lies our suffering, continued suffering. Existence is nothing but suffering, nothing but loss, nothing but forgetfulness of what we are. And we keep putting up with it, thinking it's going to be transformed. If we saw that it cannot be transformed ever, how much longer will we put up with it? Not very long, I'll tell you that. Not very long. We would dedicate our days to choosing the true alternative that returns to us to what we really want. We would dedicate our days to remembering what we are, to choosing that alternative. And it wouldn't be long until we actually recognize that it's safe to do so. Right now, because we're clinging to our defenses of existence so we can continue on with it. Those defenses actually make remembering what we are seem to be dangerous and fearful and frightening, and so we don't do it. Because we cannot carry the defenses of existence into remembering what we are, because they would twist that around and make it seem like even worse forgetting. So we have to recognize what our defenses are, how we maintain interest and allegiance and loyalty to existence, so that we can gently set those defenses down and not be afraid of letting go of them, not being afraid to be without those defenses. We've been with them for so long, we think they're part of us, you know, as if we cannot be free of them. But we have to be free of them. We have to be willing to be free of those defenses. And so satsang examines those defenses carefully, so we realize, okay, these defenses were necessary in existence to maintain our allegiance to existence. But now that we want to give up the allegiance to existence and choose allegiance to remembering what we are, those defenses serve no purpose there at all. And we can see it. We can see it absolutely clearly. And then the fear dissipates. Fear dissipates. So a satsang inquiry contemplation is all important. All important. Don't wait for a transformation first. Why are so few in inquiry and satsang contemplation? Because they're waiting for a transformation to take place. And they think, well, once the transformation takes place, I will feel that all my defenses have been validated. I'll feel validated, and then it'll be a lot easier to remember what I am. So it's circular reasoning, isn't it? Everyone's waiting for it to become easier. But what they're waiting for is a transformation of existence to take place, which will validate the purpose that they've, validate the belief they can change the purpose of effects. Validate they can separate cause and effect. Validate that they can become prime creator. That's what everyone's waiting for. That sort of validation, which never comes, never arrives. So generally, people who arrive at satsang and inquiry are those who have been severely disillusioned, who have suffered severely. And the suffering has been so extreme, and the disillusionment has been so extreme that they stumble into satsang. And almost in a state of, state of destitution and extreme suffering. Let me shut down this internet here. Let me see. Okay. And they come into inquiry just feeling like, like their lives have been blown up. And it's just, everything is falling apart. And what they tried to, success has eluded them. And so they come in feeling like, that they've just been, the destiny has dealt them a blow. And they initially expect the satsang to restore them to their former luster and renew their faith in their defenses. But satsang does the opposite. It helps you, recognize the full scope, the totality of the situation, and help you see where your salvation really is, which is to accept that you can have but a single purpose. You can only have a single purpose. And that single purpose is shared by cause and effect. It's impossible to have two purposes at the same time. It's impossible to have a cause with one purpose and an effect with a different purpose. It's impossible. And with that acceptance, then you're able to drop the defenses which were designed to make you believe it was possible. And without those need for those defenses, the light of the real world will dawn on your awareness automatically. And then that you will experience a problem-free, the light that is problem-free, the living light that is problem-free, and that will then remind you of what you are. You would say, ah, this is perfect. This is flawless. I don't need any defenses. I don't need any crazy beliefs, belief systems. So that's why blessed are those who are poor in spirit, meaning they shall inherit the kingdom, meaning poor in spirit, meaning that the wheels have come off in existence. Somehow everything that used to work doesn't work anymore, and one is absolutely feels like they've simply are a total failure, you know, feel poor in spirit. And then they stumble into the satsang inquiry. They wonder, you know, how did I get here? What is this? But the blessings arrive, and eventually they're the ones who choose to experience the real world, realize what has always been true, that they can only serve a single purpose. They realize that the prime creator is not conflicted, reality is not conflicted. They're not conflicting laws. They're not conflicting purposes. Life is not conflicted. Reality is not conflicted. It's not that the prime creator created spirit with, and then spirit decided, well, I'm going to serve a different purpose than what the prime creator created me for. It doesn't work that way. So, if you're in satsang, you're actually very blessed. Extremely blessed. Because you're going to end up to be the one who chooses to remember what you are and experience the pure bliss of and delight of problem-free life. You realize you have a problem-free life. Of course, the life in existence is nothing but problems. But you realize that's just a dream. You have another life. That is problem-free, that is eternal. It can never be sick, can never be harmed in any way. It can never be transformed in any way. Translated, yes, not transformed. Translation means you're able to set this down eventually for full, pure, direct functioning in reality. Easily translated that way, but not transformed. No such thing as transformation. How could what is become something other than what it is? Existence is what it is. It cannot become something other than what it is. It's a hypothetical scenario designed to induce forgetfulness of what we are by presenting a picture that is opposite of reality. There's no loss in reality at all. So in order to forget reality, we need to see a hypothetical scenario that of constant loss, aiming towards what we believe is total loss, which then we believe will transform into rebirth of a new creation, and we'll be prime creators. That is what existence is. There will never be any transformation of that purpose. And we don't have to learn to love existence. We cannot. It's impossible. How can we love loss? How can we love loss? Cannot. We were not created to love loss. There's no loss in reality. Love is reality. Love cannot love loss. God did not create eternalness and non-eternalness. God did not create being and non-being. God did not create life and death. God is not conflicted. God did not create the permanent and the impermanent. Created only the permanent. Created only life. God did not create invulnerability and vulnerability. God created only invulnerability. This whole scenario of impermanence, death, vulnerability, conflict, impermanence, all this stuff is a hypothetical scenario that we are imagining, that we can be a state of forgetfulness of what we are. So then we can imagine it's possible we can become something other than what we really are. Namely, prime creator. It's that simple. And you see that jackhammer there is not preventing us from holding the satsang, is it? not at all. So the poor in spirit, those who have slipped through the cracks of existence, who have just been wiped out by so much loss and has become unbearable, they end up stumbling into inquiry. Also those who have had a glimpse of reality, glimpse of single purpose, a glimpse of problem-freeness, of the living light, they also stumble into inquiry because they try to use this as motivation to solve the problems of the world and they become completely stressed out. Completely stressed out. And they feel guilty, super guilty, because they say, wow, I have all this responsibility. I was shown problem-freeness and now I'm supposed to bring that problem-freeness into the world and make the whole world problem-free and I can't do it. I'm so tired. I'm getting sick trying it. Oh, I feel so horrible. I'm letting God down, etc., etc. They stumble into inquiry too. So various types come in to stumble into inquiry. We all stumble into it. We don't stride into it, you know. We stumble into it because we're beaten up. Existence will beat you up savagely. And we're worn out. We've tried so hard to be good, to help, etc. And we think, wow, we just can never do enough. And so we stumble into inquiry, and here's somebody speaking and saying things that we've never heard before. And we listen, and they're using the same words we're familiar with, familiar words, but they're using the words in ways that we've never heard before. And we wonder, what in the world is the speaker saying? You know, it sounds familiar, but I'm not really sure what's being said here. And then you catch, you know, bits and pieces, and you try to put it together and fit it in with concepts you're familiar with and defenses. It doesn't quite fit. You know, and you say, I can't quite understand what's being said. And then you say, I need to go back to solving the problems of the world. And then you try more again and feel, you know, even more futility. And then you say, maybe I better go back to the inquiry. And I think their answers are there. And you go back and listen some more, and you hear a little better. And then there's sort of a subtle dawning, like, you know, I think there is an answer. I vaguely am seeing that there's a way out of this dilemma that I'm trapped in. There really is a way out. It's not quite sure, it's not quite clear to me what it is, but I can sense it. I intuitively feel it. There is a way out. I just need to listen a little better. And then the path is one of really listening better and better. Hearing it better and better, where what is said in inquiry eventually becomes crystal clear, and the mumblings and the jumblings and gibberish of the world is seen as simply that, just gibberish. It's frantic appeals to magic is all that it is, the magic of transformation. We can transform everything, you know. Whatever the problem is, don't worry, we can transform it. Don't worry, be happy. You cannot be happy in existence. You cannot learn to love existence. It's not a job to learn to love existence, because the purpose of existence is to forget love, forget reality. What we do is we come up with a substitute of fake love and then get attached to this and then claim that we're loving existence. It's not true. We can't love impermanence. We come up with a notion that impermanence is just temporary and it'll all be restored to us. Everything that has died will be brought back to life. And so we kind of try to feel the sweetness of how sweet that's going to be as some kind of, you know, drug to take the edge off the misery we're feeling. Some say that religion is a drug, and in a lot of ways that's true. Because it offers you a belief, faith and hope in a future transformation that takes sort of like a drug. It sort of lessens the horror of existence for us. enables us to keep going on with it instead of choosing a different scenario, choosing the problem-free scenario, which would restore our remembrance of what we are and banish the fear of remembering what we are. We evaporate. Instead of doing that, which is what the only solution there is, the only option there truly is, we either choose forgetfulness of what we are or remembrance. There is no other option. Transformation is not an option. But we keep believing that it is. We keep believing that it is. And it's a drug. That is a drug. It's the drug of belief and faith. Faith in a future transformation. Now, changes will happen, sure. Even drastic changes of all different types. But no transformation of existence. Existence remains what it is. Remains a scenario of impermanence. A scenario of loss. A scenario that enables us to forget what we are. Or be in a state of forgetfulness. Temporary state of forgetfulness. It's temporary because eventually we'll choose to remember what we are and give up the idea of trying to be prime creator. And we continue to try and separate cause and effect, pretend that we're unaware of, that we chose the idea of trying to be prime creator, which gave rise to existence. We pretend we're unaware of that, and we just focus on effects. Being unaware of the cause, we assume then we should be able to transform effects. If these effects just arose on their own, which is what many believe, that the universe just arose out of nothing. Yeah. If that's the case, the universe is nothing. And it really is meaningless. You know, it's nothing in that sense. It has no meaning. It's temporary. It's a dream. It's a mirage. But it's still a mirage. You know, let's not play games, really. I mean, it's still imaginings. It's still futility. But that, you know, suffering is there. Just hold on 1 minute. It's good to take a pause every now and then. Somebody is leaving here, so let the leaving take place. And as we're waiting for the leaving to take place, we just let this word sink in, which is a positive thing. Sometimes we need a little break. I have to remember that. Take a break here during satsang. Catch your breath. There you go. Catch your breath. Take a look at the lotus. The lotus there. It's easy for me to talk, but for those who are trying to listen better and better, it's a struggle. It's a real struggle. I know it's frustrating, but I assure you the ability to speak like this has only come through decades of struggle, of trying to listen better and better. It didn't come from practicing to be a speaker. You know, I didn't go to Toastmasters and learn how to be some speaker or anything at all. No, I spent all my time listening. Listening better. Listening to truth. Listening to satsang. Listening to contemplation. and putting it bit by putting it together, gradually letting it sink in, what's being said, hearing what is being said, being getting clear about it. That's how I spent my time. So it's a funny thing, the quiet ones, the ones who are so quiet and just listening very, very clearly, they're the ones that one day are end up being the speakers. Because they know exactly what they're talking about now, because they've listened and heard and finally realized the clarity of it all. So the best advice is to remain very quiet, meaning put all your attention into listening, put all of your effort, everything goes into listening. Don't worry about being a speaker, because when you have perfected your listening, when you have listened to the point of hearing the truth and seeing it, then automatically you can express this, because you're speaking from a standpoint of clarity. You're simply talking about what you're seeing. That's easy, right? It's very easy. I mean, anyone can do that. They can say, I'm sitting here, and there's a laptop, and there's a tree, and there's a bush, and there's a post, and there's a table, there's a chair, there's a wall, there's houses, a road, you know. Anyone can describe what they're seeing. So in satsang, I'm simply describing what I'm seeing internally. There's no desire to be a speaker as such. The desire is simply to share clarification, because understanding the situation, it's understood that it's necessary, and in sharing it, of course, it strengthens it in myself. So it's a win-win. I see that as a win-win. It's really the best way. Once you have clarified to the extent that it's easy to see, then sharing it is a win-win. But the way to put it all together is to listen very quietly, and don't feel like you need to say anything, because there is no test. You're not like, you don't need to rehearse some kind of test, giving answers to some kind of test. It's not an academic setting at all. There's no professor. There's no diploma. There's no degree being awarded here at all. It's only your own salvation that is chosen. And by choosing it for yourself, you're choosing it for everyone. You're saying, hey, this is here for you too. Problem-free world is there for equally for everyone. There's no exclusivity or exclusion policy at all. It's not like some university, some Ivy League university, where you need good grades to get in, and only those who have the best grades and the best of the best get in, and everyone else is excluded. No, the real world welcomes everyone. It's just you can't bring your defenses in. You have to leave them at the outside, you know. You can't bring them in with you. That's it. Because you would then feel you're being attacked most severely. Because you'd feel like, I don't want to transform this. I have no desire to transform this. And to suddenly say, oh my gosh, I'm going to let go of my belief in transformation. How horrible. It's trying to dispossess me of my treasures. So you'd feel as if the real world is some complete treachery to you, because you feel your belief in transformation slipping away. You have no more interest in it. And you say, oh my gosh, how treacherous it is. My greatest treasure, it's causing me to lose my grasp on my greatest treasure. And then you think it's completely treacherous, you see. So you cannot enter it that way. You have to leave your defenses outside, you know, outside the kingdom. There's no need for them there, and it only will cause you to react as if reality is completely treacherous, as if problem-free world is completely treacherous to you, dispossessing you of your treasures. That's why inquiry is so incredibly important. You literally cannot bring your defenses with you as you step into nirvana, step into the problem-free world, the real world, the living light, the peace beyond understanding, the seamless oneness. You cannot bring your defenses with you. And if you think that your defenses there are what your treasures really are, then you will literally feel as if you've stepped into the most treacherous place imaginable. And you will quickly retreat out of there. Quickly. Very quickly. So, I'm just saying this is a fact. What I'm saying, this is the truth. I see it very, very clearly. And, you know, I see the troubles that people have with this whole situation and suffering. They keep putting themselves through the same old thing over and over, trying to get a tighter grasp of their defenses so that when they go into the living light of the problem-free world, that somehow they'll be able to maintain their grasp of their defenses, that they won't start to slip away. Literally, that is what spirituality of the world is doing. It's trying to empower you to grasp your defenses even tighter, so that you, when you enter into the problem-free living light, you won't feel them slipping away. You think you'll be able to maintain them. And occasionally then we take another glimpse of reality and we feel our defense is slipping away again. We say, doggone it, I've got to go work harder. I haven't done enough work on the path. And so we do, you know, another 10 years of grasping our defenses tighter through some kind of, you know, spiritual practices. And then we try again and we feel our defenses slipping away again. We feel ourselves becoming completely disinterested in maintaining our defenses. And we say, oh no, I haven't succeeded. How terrible. I need to find a better guru. I need to find a better master. Or a guru-ess. Need to find someone who can help me maintain my defenses better when I enter into this living light, you know, this problem-freeness. I keep losing interest in my defenses. How terrible. I can't live without them. They're my treasures. I want to carry my treasures with me, and I keep letting them slip away, you know. How awful. I gotta find the guru-ess or the guru who will teach me how to do this, because surely they have succeeded at this too. That's why they're so wonderful and great. They've got it all, you know. And so we continue on with this over and over and over and over and over, wasting lifetime after lifetime after lifetime, until finally we feel, oh my gosh, the guru-ess and the guru have completely let me down. They're incapable of helping me. And you stumble into satsang, you stumble into inquiry, and there's just a simple speaker there who's just, you know, very quietly pointing out, you know, the situation. And you're listening and say, well, what is this? What is this? They're telling me I don't need to my defenses. And they're explaining why I don't need my defenses. And they say, oh my, and then you realize, oh my gosh, all this time I've been really trying to find a way to hold on to them, hold on to the belief in transformation. And now I'm seeing I never needed it in the first place. And oh my gosh, then you start thinking, wow, maybe I won't have to keep being reborn over and over. Maybe I won't have to keep making the same mistakes over and over. Maybe I can be free. Yes, and then real hope dawns. There's a moment when true hope arrives. I've experienced that, and I tell you, you know, when it arrives, you know it. And it's kind of like you look around and you say, oh, I hope nobody saw that arrival of true hope. I hope my guru didn't see that. Maybe they'll kick me out. I hope the guru-ess is not aware that I have true hope, and I really don't need these. I don't need transformation. I don't need the belief in transformation anymore. I don't need these defenses. I'm gonna let go of them sometime. I hope they don't know that, because I'm gonna lose favor with them. They're gonna say, oh, gee, you know, you've really slipped, haven't you? You really slipped, you know, and then they'll say, well, don't worry, you'll bounce back from that, and you'll regain your belief in transformation. You've just kind of backslid a little bit. And you'll kind of go, I don't know. I don't think so. I think I saw real hope. I really saw it. And so you cling. See, don't doubt in the dark what you saw in the light. Very important. Because when in the light you see that you don't need transformation. You don't need the belief in transformation. And when you live in the light, the living light, you don't need any belief in transformation. Because living light is permanent, is eternal, will always be that way. It itself will never be transformed. So there's no adjustments that need to be made, no transformations need to be made. And you will know that for sure. And then when you go back in the darkness, you'll think, oh my gosh, I need the belief in transformation. This dark is so terrible, I gotta transform it somehow. And then you'll see transformation as your treasure once again, and you'll look for the guru S or the guru to show you how to cling to it and hold on to it better. In order to kind of like, you know, arc weld it to your being. So it can never be separated. Everybody's learning how to be arc welders. Absolutely riveting, you know, rivet it. Rivet this belief in transformation to our being so we can never be without it. We're all trying to do that. We're all thinking that been doing this, we're the ones who are going to be saved. And we look at those poor fools over in inquiry and contemplation, spending all their time listening to this speaker, blah, blah, blah. And we think, they're wasting their time. What a waste of time. They're not riveting transformation into their very soul and very being and essence. Not riveting it there. They're not welding it. Instead, they're just talking about letting go of it. You know, how crazy is that? Wow. They must be completely crazy. We're the ones, the welders here, we're the ones who are going to be saved. Those other ones, they're going to be lost, completely lost in misery and darkness and suffering. How terrible. I feel so awful for them. Maybe I need to help them, wake them up and get them back to the welding process. That's, you know, of course, that's what happens when you're really into inquiry. You know, you don't want to tell anybody because they'll tell you you're wasting your time. They say, why don't you get back to welding the belief in transformation into your being? Of course, you cannot weld lies onto truth. Truth is Teflon, you know. It cannot join. Truth and lies cannot be joined together. It's impossible. So all this welding work we're doing is just welding lies onto other lies. Defining a lie as true and then welding another lie onto that and saying, now this other lie is now true because it's welded to truth. But it's not, it's just welded to another lie. So we're not wasting our time here at all. We're realizing we don't need to maintain our grasp upon our defenses, that which enabled us to continue on with existence, because we're not continuing on with existence at all. Our path diverges, and we're saying, we are choosing remembrance of what we are, which is not existence at all. It's the alternative to existence. It's the real world. It's the problem-free world. Where we don't lose anything. It's the loss-free world. It's a loss-free experience. The experience of no loss. And in that experience, we don't need any defenses. It's effortless to continue on with that. We don't need the belief we can transform what we're experiencing into something completely opposite. Because that would only frighten us, wouldn't it? That would only cause us complete terror. Because we'd look and say, how in the world can I do this? I don't think I can do it. We'd end up feeling helpless and hopeless and stupid and insignificant and futile. Because we say, I don't see any way that I can transform this problem-free experience I'm having into something opposite of what it is. And then judging on that, we'd say, wow, this is hopeless, this is impossible, I don't want this. And we go back to existence and we'd say, ah, here, I think I can transform everything because I can put a different frame around everything. I can keep changing the frame, keep changing that, keep changing. And we'd say, oh, this loss, it's okay because I'm going to be able to transform it all at some point. And we'd feel, you know, more back in the saddle again. So we simply raise these issues up to awareness so that awareness can ponder on them, can contemplate them, and just see it. Existence sees it. It's intelligent, you know. I mean awareness. Our awareness sees it. And our awareness is intelligent. Our awareness looks at it and says, huh, wow, I really have been deceiving myself. And I see why, I see how and why. And I see that I don't have to keep doing that. And the only reason I didn't see it before was I refused to look at it. You know, we keep ourselves in darkness here. I always say that being born in this world is to be born a mushroom. We're kept in the dark and fed nothing but crap, nothing but lies, total lies. Manure, I mean, mushrooms are raised on manure, you know, and so we're all mushrooms here, as it were, because existence, only our allegiance to it only continues because we refuse to look at what's going on. We refuse to look deep enough. We keep ourselves in the dark about the cause of it all. And the defenses that we use, we keep ourselves in the dark. We don't inquire. Really, that's my testimony to everybody. I came into this world ready to do inquiry, ready to do contemplation, ready to share the truth with everyone. And I found out nobody was interested in that. Nobody. They only are interested in transformation. And so I had to figure out, how can I tailor my message and accommodate everybody's obsession with transformation, you know? And so I had to jump through all these hoops and everything was terrible. And everyone here, they wanted to stay mostly in the dark. They didn't want to look at what's been hidden in darkness. They didn't want to do it. So, you know, what can I do? If people don't want to do it, there's nothing I can do. Nothing any teacher can do. If one insists on remaining in darkness, keeping the cause of existence obscure, keeping the defenses obscure, and at all costs not looking there, and then insisting that they want to be helped, they want to be transformed, meaning they don't want to suffer. It's impossible. Nobody can accomplish that. Only by turning, facing the darkness and looking, can one then see what's going on. And when one looks, it's no longer dark. The darkness comes from the not looking. The obscurity comes from the not looking. The confusion comes from the not looking. That's where it comes from. As soon as you look at it, you say, oh, that's not dark. That's not obscure. That's not confusing. I see it clearly. How can it be in the dark if I'm seeing it? Cannot. So our seeing brings the light. Our seeing is the light in existence. It brings the light, a certain type of light, as it were. So it's no longer in darkness. We can see. It doesn't transform existence. But it makes the choice of letting go of transformation easy. You see? It makes the belief in transformation easy. And it's simply that we're not willing to look because we've terrorized ourselves into not looking. We think if we look, we'll lose everything. But we're already dwelling in a scenario of constant loss. What will happen if we look is we'll lose loss. we'll see that loss, we don't want it anymore. So when we set down loss, what are we losing? Not losing anything. Losing loss means to be free of loss. So the looking is not harming us. It's seeing how everything can be restored to us. Everything we thought that we lost, how come we can see that it never happened? We only symbolized it. It's not that all the dead are going to arise. We're going to realize that nothing ever died in the first place. Okay, that's the truth. The delusion is to think that everything that we think that has we've lost here, all the bodies, and all the things, all the friendships, relationships, everything, they will all be restored. They'll all be brought back to life. That's the delusion in transformation. The truth is that nothing has ever died. No reality has never suffered any loss of any kind whatsoever. And that we can remember this. So all our life, all our relationships, everything is still immaculately present for us, as it's always been. That's the truth. That's the realization. There's no need for magic or transformation for reality to be what it is and to remain always what it is. It's not that we're going to figure out how to transform the world into the kingdom of heaven. It's that we'll realize that the kingdom of heaven has always been present for us and accept that. Again, no transformation, just acceptance of what's always been the case. And what's always been the case, what need do we have for transformation? Why do we need to transform eternity? Why do we need to transform invulnerability? Why do we need to transform permanence? Transform internal delight? Why do we need to transform eternal life? Why do we need any belief in transformation whatsoever? We don't. Not in reality. Only in existence, which is nothing but constant loss. Aiming at total loss. Do we need the belief in transformation just to make us think that somehow this is going to become better for us and we'll all be, all our suffering will pay off? That keeps us going, keeps us suffering. Say, I'll take another birth because this next birth is going to be a transforming one. Because transformation is bound to happen this lifetime. It's got to happen. Again, all sorts of changes happen. What is that? A piece of paper just suddenly appeared. Which brings us, okay, to the written word. Let's talk about the written word. There's no words in reality. There's no writing. There's no need. Everything's perfectly clear. All communication is perfectly clear. Words are simply subject to interpretation. There's no interpretation in reality whatsoever. None. Words are the least clear things. They're very unclear. What words? The use of words is extremely unclear. Because every single word is subject to interpretation. It's subject to interpreting context, purpose, direction, meaning, everything. And you just ascribe a meaning to the words, whatever it is you want them to mean. You know, you come across situations where you talk to people and you say yes, and they interpret what you said as no. Or you say no, and they interpret what you say as yes. Or come across situations where what you mean is really yes, but you say no. Or what you really mean is no, but you say yes. Literally. Or you say something like, you need to turn right, and then the person turns left. And they said, I thought you said turn left. Happens all the time. Because the only plausible way we can be prime creator is simply to believe that reality is subject to definition, and that however we define something, that's what it is. In other words, isness comes from our own definition. And if we define a tree as a car, then it's really a car. Or, you know, if we define yes as no, then it really means no. And we have established a fact through our own definition, our own interpretation definition. Words are totally imprecise and subject to infinite interpretations. So it's not possible for there to be a true curriculum based on words. It's impossible. No two people will interpret the words the same way. Only seeing the dynamic. Seeing is free of words. You see it. You see how it works. And then you can express this, share it with others, saying, basically saying, hey, you need to look at this. Which is basically all I'm saying. You need to look, inquire, and see. That's all I'm really saying. You have to see it for yourself. There's no formulation of words that can equal seeing at all. Because other people can disagree with your words, and who's to say who's right? They can have a different interpretation, and they'll claim their interpretation is the same as better than yours, or just as good. But in the seeing, there's no interpretation taking place. It's direct. You see it, your reaction, like, wow, oh my gosh, see, huh, I saw it. And it absolutely is possible to see clearly. And then, of course, you can attach words to the seeing, which is fine to share it, communicate it, but all you're saying is, take a look, take a look, take a look, take a look. And people say, gee, I don't know what you mean by take a look. I thought you meant, don't look. What can you do, right? But the message is communicated by saying, you need to take a look. You need to see. And of course, some will say that, oh, I thought you meant, don't see, don't look. They say, I thought you meant, don't look. No, I mean, take a look. See, look at it. Inquire, contemplate, listen carefully. Not to the structure of the language, not to the words, etc., but to what the words are pointing towards. Kind of the words are basically just assurance and saying, hey, look, you know, if someone doesn't look within, they want to be sure there's something there to see. And so someone who has looked is just giving assurance, saying, yeah, there is something there to see. You'll see. You'll see that there's these defenses, and you'll see what the defenses are, how they work. And then you'll realize that in choosing, you know, the problem-free world, you realize those defenses are going to cause an adverse reaction. You'll see that. They have to. Reason. It's completely reasonable. You'll see the chain of causation, the dynamics there. And you'll say, well, of course, they have to. They have to cause that reaction. It's not a matter of our will or we're choosing the reaction. That has to cause that reaction. It's inevitable. And when seeing that it's inevitable, then we realize, oh, we can't take these defenses with us. We'll see, that's perfectly apparent. Cannot take those defenses with us. And then we'll see, well, okay, they were necessary to keep hope and existence alive and keep believing the goal can be reached, and now they're not necessary in I can, there's no threat to my experiencing to be free of them. So the fear is lessened, the fear of experiencing problem-free, the light of the real world, problem-free light, fear gets lessened, more and more and more and more lessened. It doesn't come instantly. I mean, it hasn't even dawned on me yet. But I'm aware that the fear, defense, the fear of it is much, 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 much less. So there is that awareness. I can just feel within, where's the anxiety? There isn't any. Where's that knot of fear? It's not there. It used to be there. I used to have terrible knot of fear. Whenever I would consider, you know, stepping, allowing the awareness of living light, problem-free light, nirvana, bliss, whenever I considered turning and accepting that, I'd feel this terrible knot of fear. Horrible. Terrified. Because I was still believing that I could take my defenses with me. But now, when I think about it, there's not even a tingle of anxiety. Not even a tingle of fear. Maybe subtle, slight uneasiness, you know. But, you know, that's to be expected. You can't completely eradicate it prior to actually allowing it. Because there's always the unknown, kind of the uneasiness of the unknown. That will remain until it actually dawns upon us. But really, inquiry can bring it to that stage where there's just a slight ripple of uneasiness, uncertainty. It's kind of like the uneasiness of uncertainty. Concepts can never bring 100% certainty. Only experience can bring it. So maybe I'm at 99%, you know. But there's always that, you know, 1% of uncertainty. Can't banish that. Don't need to. Because the living light understands that. Problem-free world understands that. And when we've reached that state of 99%, you know, percent, just a tiny bit of uncertainty left, then that can easily bridge that gap there. And knowing that you won't be thrown into panic and defensive reactions, that you're losing your sweeties, your treasures. You won't be terrified about that. Feel like you're being attacked by some treacherous monster. You might have just residual uncertainties, you know, but that's the testimony. Testimony of those who've done it, you know. I believe it, and I believe their testimony, because my reason sees it very clearly. This is so, this is true. Reason is like a different type of sight. It actually sees way more clearly than eyesight. Infinitely more clearly. Eyesight doesn't see at all, really. Your eyes, what you're perceiving, is really, how you say it? It's not really seeing at all. It's awareness of spatial relationships, etc. But what we're seeing, the eyes don't give anything meaning at all. At all. The eyes don't really see. In the true term of seeing at all, reason sees very clearly. The ego sees insanely. It sees defensively. But reason sees clearly. It's real seeing. And so reason has to be used. There's also intuition. It is based on reason, but there's a way of a felt intuition which also sees clearly. But the basis of reason is saying that truth and lies can't both be true. You know, things like that. Reason sees this. It says, yeah, it's obvious. This is reality. Reason is reality based. Comes from reality. It's like the smile of reality, you know, that's still smiling for us. We just have to turn there and we realize reason is there for us. It's just like just saying, hey, you're not, no trouble. Salvation's easy. No problem. Easy. You're gonna reach it, no problem. Sure, there's gonna be a little uncertainty, etc., but we'll work through that. Easy. Reason is that smile of assurance that reality is giving us, that we can see how we've trapped ourselves. We can see where our resistance is coming from, and in the seeing of it, we can realize it's all. There's no reason to be afraid. Eyesight is really neutral. It's just presenting reflected light to the, you know, into the brain, That's all it's really doing. All interpretation, all meaning, etc., is done at deeper, deeper levels of consciousness and awareness and processing and, you know, putting meaning and definition onto everything that our eyes are, the light that our eyes are letting in. A reason doesn't need any of that to tell it what is true. It already knows what is true. It doesn't look to existence to figure out what is true. It already knows what is true. And then just tells us to look upon what is not true and see that it's not true. And to see how it holds us back. Our defenses hold us back from our happiness by holding out a false happiness that we'll never reach. Again, defenses are entirely designed to keep us slaving away, trying to reach a goal we can't reach. And if defenses keep us terrified of reality, so of course we won't turn in that direction. They keep us believing that in transformation, that we can transform all the suffering. And of course we're taught myriads of ways to do this, and there are infinite more ways we can be taught, and none of them work. We don't have to go through all of them to find out none of them work. Transformation in any form doesn't work. So why do we have to go through all the forms? Reason sees the very root of it and says from the very beginning there's no possibility of ever working. So why do we need to go through every single futile gesture and to see that it's all futile? No, reason saves us time. If transformation doesn't work, then why do we have to try on all sorts of forms of transformation? We would see that's just a waste of our time. Unless we wanted to waste time. If we want to waste time, we can do that. But let's be clear that we're wasting time. Not getting anywhere. Existence isn't getting anywhere. There is no pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. There is no transformation into being prime creator for us. None. It's not like those who stick it out the longest will get the pot of gold. There is no pot of gold. So sticking it out the longest time, what is that? What is that? What does it get us? Absolutely nothing. Does it get us something more than those who don't stick it out? No. No, it doesn't get it. All of reality belongs to everyone already. So it's impossible for anyone to have more than someone else. It's impossible. It's impossible for anyone to have less than someone else. That's impossible. So how can sticking out the path of misery and trail of tears of existence, hoping longer that we can transform and become prime creator, how does sticking that out longer in someone else result in anyone having more or someone having less? Of course, if someone has more, then less also automatically comes into the picture, right? More. It does not. It does not at all. So the idea of somehow if we just hold out a little longer, we're going to get more is, again, complete defensiveness, made up. We've simply made it up. It's a way to keep our motivation going. Of course, if we think, well, you know, if I just have one more life and I hang in there and don't give up, I will end up being transformed and having more than those who gave up earlier. That's motivation, isn't it? That's how we motivate ourselves. It's all this complete lie. We just made it up. It has no basis in reality whatsoever. We don't need to hang in there. We're not going to get any more for hanging in there. When we say we're going to have more, we're putting our faith in transformation. That's what we're really doing. And ultimately, we're putting our faith in that we can be prime creator. Be more than what we really are, you see. easy stuff, but not so easy if you're trying to, you know, it's hard, you can't see light and darkness at the same time. So if you're trying to see, be confused and be clear at the same time, then, you know, it's very tough, isn't it? If you want to go in two different directions at the same time, then one feels like a great struggle is taking place. And of course, since we're used to treasuring our defenses, when we are undergoing a process of realizing that they're a treasure in existence, so to speak, but they're a complete block and hindrance to freedom from suffering and misery, you know, then there may be a slight struggle feeling, you know, a feeling of, you know, I want to both treasure it and not treasure it at the same time. We can't do that, but what we can do is recognize that, yes, in existence, it seemed like a great treasure. We're not denying that at all. Because the belief in transformation is the central treasure of existence, because it keeps us loyal to existence. So in that sense, it's seemed like a great treasure. It'll always seem that way in existence. No problem. We're not challenging that. What we're saying is, it's completely unneeded in experiencing problem-free world. Not only is it unneeded, you cannot bring it with you. It's not a treasure there at all. It simply isn't there. So it's not a question of judging whether it's a treasure or not. It simply isn't there. It's not needed at all. The belief is not needed. Because we don't want to transform what we're experiencing. This is no call for it whatsoever. No call for that hope, that belief. So we're not attacking anything in satsang. Nothing's being attacked. We're simply putting it in right context. So you're if you want to keep believing in existence, of course, transformation will be your, that belief will be your great treasure, will seem to be. But if you realize that, hey, you know, transformation hasn't come yet, and maybe it never will, then you open up to looking at it, the whole situation, and seeing the alternative. But nothing has to be attacked, or destroyed, or torn to pieces, or anything like that. So satsang is not impossible. It's not as difficult as we assume it to be. Really, it's just this tug of war, you know, and false context. When you develop the right context, then the whole thing seems, why did I ever think it was difficult? It's the context that causes us to feel it's very difficult. It's the belief somehow we're being called on to do both existence and the real world simultaneously. Or being called upon to transform the real world. Or being called, because all this is the wrong context. We believe that this belief in transformation has come from God, that somehow our duty is to transform existence. You know, as long as we believe that, how can we let go of transformation? We will believe we must transform whatever experience we have. We have to have that belief in transformation. So that brings us back to cause of existence. Very important. It's a key to it. And this is the one area that everyone comes up short on. Here comes the mail delivery person. To be PC about it, or why would you call it? You'd have to have some better title than mail delivery. Communication expert. Here comes the communication expert. causation is all important. As I said, this is the area that I see in the world that is most causing the most difficulty and problems, which is why I focused on it. Without question, almost nobody here, and there's no tradition on this planet that looks at the causation of existence, truly looks at. This is what everyone avoids. And by avoiding that, it makes inquiry and satsang extremely difficult. Almost, I'd say, prohibitively difficult. Because we then, if we don't look at causation, we can simply assert, without any evidence to the contrary, because we're not looking there, we can simply assert that, well, God wants us to transform existence. That's the purpose why God put us here, to transform existence, to build, establish the kingdom of heaven on earth. We can simply assert that. And since we're not looking at causation at all, we say there's no evidence to the contrary. You know, if we turn our back on something, if I turn my back on this video camera, I can assert anything at all. I can say, behind my back there's the Grand Canyon, you know. And someone says, no, there isn't. I say, what do you mean there isn't? I believe there is. And then someone says, well, why don't you turn around and look? I say, no, I don't need to turn around and look. I know what's there. It's the Grand Canyon is there. So, of course, if we refuse to look at causation, we can assert anything we want to, however ridiculous it is. That suits our purposes. But it's totally dishonest, isn't it, to refuse to look at what's there, look at causation. Because if you refuse to look, you feel you can assert anything and there's no evidence to the contrary. But that's dishonest. Because why don't we validate it by turning around and looking? But we don't, because it enables us to maintain our belief in transformation, belief that we can be prime creator. But that is really the essential problem of this world, is complete neglect of causation. I've never come across anyone who, you know, emphasizes causation. You got to look at it. No tradition here of doing that. What caused existence to rise in the first place? Even the gurus here don't pay any attention to that, really. They say, well, I don't know. Who knows? Nobody knows. Nobody knows why existence arose. It's a mystery. It's a secret. It's all mysterious, but, you know, it's not important anyway. Ah, I hear that and I say, oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, how can anyone say that? It's all important to look at causation. Because then you will see we have made up all these defenses ourselves. We've made up the belief in transformation ourselves. God didn't do it. It's not coming from God, it's coming from us. Therefore, we're not bound to it. We simply made up this arbitrary belief that we have to transform existence as a necessary defense to keep our hope alive. And therefore, we can set it down. If it came from God, we couldn't set it down. And if it came from God and therefore we can't set it down, it's literally impossible for us to allow the light of the real problem-free world to dawn upon us. Impossible, because we would feel it as experience we're being totally attacked by infinite treachery. So that maintains us saying existence is all there is. That reinforces this belief, this is all there is. This is home. We have to work at it. We have to transform it. Circular illogic. All because we refuse to look at causation. I think the gurus who say don't worry about it realize that it's quite an effort and takes quite a bit of time to clarify this. And almost everyone that comes to them aren't going to do that. So they basically are saying, well, all I can do for you then is just assure you that it's safe to just jump into the problem-free experience. And once you get there, you'll realize you don't need the defenses. So just leap. I say, they don't even, because they realize that those who come to them aren't going to look at causation anyway. So why even, they just say, I don't know. I don't know what caused all this. I really don't know. That reassures them, the questioners say, oh, okay, good. I don't have to look there. And they say, okay, now just leap. Just take my word for it. Trust me. Just leap into the problem-free. Allow the light to dawn upon you. And of course, if they trust the guru 100% and they do this, theoretically, they will allow the light to dawn upon them. But the habit of familiarity is so strong, they will attempt to drag belief of transformation along with them, which will then cause a rebound effect. Which is why some might leap and then they retreat. And then the guru says, you know, I've been teaching so long and nobody is awakened. Nobody's been able to maintain it, etc., etc. So, I don't know. I mean, I assume the gurus know their business. And maybe those who do leap can maintain it somehow. Can see it intuitively. But on the other hand, the importance of looking at causation is, from my standpoint, so extremely important. It's, I call it the safe way, the sure way, the certain way. Like, I feel certain I'm going to have the light of the problem-free world dawn upon me. I feel certain of it because I've taken the safe way, the certain way, which is to look at causation. I've been willing to do it, and I've banished all the darkness, all the fear. I've banished it, you know. It's banished. It's gone. It's not going to return. It's not like I just leapt in into problem-free experiencing and had all this darkness, left all this darkness behind, boom, you know. No, I mean, Now I look everywhere. There's no darkness in my mind. There's no darkness in my beliefs. I've looked everywhere. Probably almost everywhere. Maybe there's a little tiny speck somewhere. I don't know, but I'll look at that too. And so I say, okay. There's no lack of clarity here. I'm going from clarity into effortless, problem-free experiencing. It's an easy translation. It's not a leap, really. And I'm not, you know, throwing a whole bunch of baggage down, you know. Belief in transformation. I don't have any belief in transformation. Or at least extremely little. The defenses are very, very, very minor. So I'm really not letting go of very much. It's kind of like someone standing in a hot air balloon, the gondola of a hot air balloon, and they have all these lead weights, you know, like tons of lead weight. And they, somehow they're able to, the bottom to drop out, and all the lead weight just, you know, drops down on the ground. The hot air balloon just goes, up like that, wham, you know. Wow, and then they start going up faster and faster and faster and faster. And they go, oh my gosh, this is too fast. I want the lead weights back. And somehow they grab manufacture lead weights out of the air and fill the gondola with lead weights, reestablish the floor, and the balloon goes hurtling back to earth. You know, boom, they hit the earth and they're all shaken up. So, my gosh, that was a crazy trip I went on, you know. I'm going to tell everybody else about that. But here, it's like I've been jettisoning the lead weight, jettisoning it, bit by bit. You know, there's very little lead weight in the gondola anymore, and the balloon's just sitting there very peacefully. And I drop the last weight off, you know, and the gondola will just rise very, 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 very gently. Like that. There's no fear it's going to go hurtling up through the atmosphere or something. There's very little fear that the living light will come on me like lightning, you know. No, it's more likely just the softest, subtlest dawning, gentlest of dawning. So I'm waiting for it. I'm waiting for it. And that's the certain way. That's the way that I advocate. If you can leap into it, you know, then you're gonna leap into it. Maybe there's been a few that have done that. By and large, the safe, certain way is really the way that's going to work for most people. And, you know, in order to do that way, you need to dedicate yourself and really work at it. You've got to be a workaholic. But most of us are workaholics anyway, right? I'm definitely a workaholic. It's just that I spent my efforts at inquiry. In a previous life, I spent my efforts at composing music. I was a total workaholic. Really. Absolute, you know, craftsman. High craftsman that just worked like crazy. And so I had the workaholic ethic, you know, had that. So I just turned that towards satsang, towards inquiry, and became a workaholic at that. And, you know, some of us may feel like, oh, it's too much work. But really, most of us are workaholics anyway. So it's only just simply doing what you're used to doing. I didn't find that an imposition upon me. I said, thank God I got something I can work on constantly. Right? That's great. I like to be constantly working at something. And most of us are that way. There's going to be something. We could be working on business, our career, being a homemaker, raising a family, socializing, you know, whatever it is, we're probably working at that, you know, constantly. You know, whatever I did, I'd be working at it constantly. If I loved for a while basketball. I'd be out shooting basketball hoops 6 to 8 hours a day. I was literally shooting at nighttime in the backyard when it was pitch dark. And I said, well, I know the basket is. I can still shoot even though I can't even see the basket. And then later I hooked up lights, you know. And I'd practice till midnight. So whatever I did, I'd be doing it, you know, full bore. Trying to be the absolute best I could possibly be at it. Trying to be, you know, can be perfect at it. Played guitar, I'd practice guitar 10 hours a day till my fingers would be so sore, just, you know, just painful. I'd still keep playing, I wouldn't stop. It's like that. Most of us are workaholics, so that's why the path of inquiry is natural for so many of us. Very natural. Simply become a workaholic on inquiry. Intelligent, though, not mindlessly. You're not like a machine. That's the path of the tortoise. The tortoise and the hare. The hare says, I'll just leap into reality. The tortoise says, no, I'm gonna be a workaholic on inquiry. And then when the tortoise gets to the last stage, the tortoise will just say, there's only one little step. It's no big step. I don't have to leap at all. I'm right here. There's only like, you know, one more inch to go. Where's the big leap? There's no big leap. Whereas the hare is thinking, okay, I gotta figure out how I can leap, you know, 10 yards at one leap here. And the tortoise is, the hare is always working out. How can I get that big leap? And then maybe the hare never can quite get that big leap because it's so used to leaping really big. Once it leaps into reality and then it says, well, I gotta leap again. And it looks around, where do I leap to? It's all the same here. It's all perfect. I need to leap back into existence. So the hare's leaping back and forth, you know, and then the hare says, this is crazy. This is so crazy. I can't handle this. So it's the tortoise that wins the race because the tortoise is saying, well, no, I just need to take one more little baby step and there it is. It's exactly the same as I've always been doing. I've been working on this for a lifetime, you know. Of course it's simple now. It's easy. So be the tortoise. Be the workaholic that you are. Just use that in the right way. Become a workaholic on inquiry. Become a workaholic on clarification. Become a workaholic on moving towards realization. It's not a leap. You're not moving towards a leap. The charismatic gurus will tell you, you gotta leap. You gotta make that leap. Because they know, some of them, not all of them are bogus, but they know that if you're a leaper, you'll also leap back into existence, and then you'll become so terrified of your leaping experience, like, oh my gosh, what happened? I leapt, and then suddenly the thought was perfect, and suddenly it became all treacherous, and I'm so scared. And then they'll turn to the guru for, save me, guru, save me. And the guru will say, yeah, of course, I know how to save you from all that. It's if you just, you know, work for me and slave for me and build a kingdom for me. I'll save you from all this that terrible trip that you experienced. You know, that's the problem. Whereas if you're a tortoise, you're not looking for any leap. You're not looking for any guru to give you a leap, a boost. Yes, a boost, but it's a gentle boost. I say it's a big boost, meaning that the fact that someone capable of giving a gentle boost is here, that is a big deal, very big deal for us. But the boost itself is the most subtle and gentle kind of thing possible. They just say, just take a few more baby steps. Not a problem. Very different, you see. So, although it's not impossible to leap and stay in there, I think my observations of the world is that there are gurus, fake gurus, I call them, that who are really interested in having a bunch of everybody serve their own aggrandizement and luxury and comforts, and they have some way of getting other people to take that leap into problem-free experience. They somehow are able to motivate them to do it, to take a leap, but inevitably those people leap back out of it because they've kept their belief in transformation, and that caused them to be terrified of, and they leap out and they say, oh my gosh, it was so beautiful for a while, and then it turned horrible, terrifying. And then they're in a state of extreme vulnerability, and then the guru's easily able to say, hey, you know, listen, you know, I know what your problem was, and I can solve that problem for you if you just need to, you know, do some service for me. And the person was so scared, they're willing to agree to anything at that point. Because they said, oh my gosh, I thought I had perfection, and it suddenly transformed into this horrible attack, treacherous attack on me. Why? Because they had the belief in transformation with them. That's why. And the belief in transformation will make it seem like the problem-free light is totally treacherous because it's causing the belief in transportation to slip away, right? We've talked about that. So they will feel like, oh my God, what happened? What happened? What happened? And the guru will say, well, look, I can protect you from that. I can protect you from that. How does the fake guru protect from that? By not leading them to truth, by saying serve, have them go into service of that fake guru and do all this stuff instead of real inquiry, so they won't be tempted to go back to the problem-free light. They think that the guru itself is better than the problem-free light. And so they think they have the cake eat too. One, they don't have to go back to the problem-free light, so they won't ever experience that flip-flop feeling of treachery again. And two, they don't have to go back because the guru is better than the living light, right? So they just keep worshiping and focusing on the guru. That protects them from ever experiencing that flip-flop, the terrible flip-flop again. You know, and, you know, existence has figured that out. And so there are these fake gurus that arise in existence that do just that. They say, hey, I'm God. And I'm look at me, I'm greater than anything you can possibly experience. I'm even greater than the greatest experience you can ever have. And those are then who flip-flop, who jump into reality and then jump back out because they weren't prepared, properly prepared for it, then cling to this guru thinking, they will save me from this because I don't need to go back into to the problem-free living light. I don't need to go back in unconditional love because this guru is better, but they have is better for me. Which is, of course, just a complete delusion. But again, the guru will preach transformation. Say, yeah, I'm better. The guru will say that they're better than what you experienced, but you're not quite aware of it because you haven't been transformed yet. But as soon as you reach this transformation, then you'll realize it. So there's all of that silliness going on, you know. But if you're the tortoise, you know, you can see that silliness. I said, what? That's nonsense. That's what they're teaching here. Complete nonsense. So you didn't see me at the feet of these fake masters. You didn't see me there because I said, hey, you know, I'm working nonstop on clarification every single day. And you know, I just don't have the time for that stuff. It just, it doesn't seem to really be where it's at, really. You know, I got to keep working here. I'm not going to sit around worshiping some guru. I got to clarify. I've seen the work I need to do, and I need to keep doing it. Because I see the problem. You know, I see that you can't have your cake and eat it too. I've got a glimpse of that. You can't maintain the belief in transformation when you're experiencing perfection. You cannot. It will slip away from you. And so I need to recognize the problem here. What is the problem? Let me see the problem so it can be solved. And of course, eventually, those fake gurus, the whole thing falls apart and people realize they've just been conned. And they've wasted all their time, effort, and money, and everything just aggrandizing this guru, and this guru has just been exploiting them totally. Eventually, they see that. And then when they see, then the guru dies, you know, leaves. Guess there's no more. The game's up. The jig is up. And those people will just say, oh my gosh, they're despondent, you know. And eventually, I guess, maybe they stumble into satsang and they say, what about this teacher? What about that teacher? What about, you know, what about these teachers, you know, who, you know, ripped them off for so long? Well, you know, the answer is not what about those teachers. It's be the tortoise. Be a workaholic. Get your own clarity. Get your own seeing. So that you'll realize what that leap, why you rebounded from it. So you can get to the point where it's no longer a leap at all. So there's no rebound. You know, if it's just one gentle step, then even if we get frayed, all we have to take is one gentle step back too, right? There's no power leap. You know, there's no guru, super magnetic, charismatic, Shakti guru who's like firing everybody up to take this rocket leap, you know, propel themselves into reality. There's none of that. There's only this very gentle, you know, take this one very gentle little tiny baby step softly, quietly. It's only that, and then if you feel too uneasy, you can take a super soft, gentle baby step back. See, everything, you get right back to this clarity. I mean, this clarity right now is just one super small baby step away from experiencing the living light. That's all that it is. So those who have been freaked out by having this charismatic Shakti gurus propel them, you know, into this experience, and they rebounded from it, and they're just like freaked out by it all. That, you know, they stumble into satsang and inquiry and say, "Oh my gosh, what about this teacher? They, you know, they freaked me out." I don't. Well, inquiry, soft, gentle, quiet, no pressure. Take baby steps. Be a workaholic. Work at it every day. That'll calm them down eventually. Eventually, calms everyone down. They say, "Oh yeah, okay, it'll take me a little longer than I thought. But this is the certain, safe way. There's not going to be any rebound here. That problem's going to be solved. And the benefit is you're not going to be vulnerable to any of those charismatic Shakti guru types." They still remain problematical, you know, but keep your distance. Because we're all vulnerable to that, aren't we? We're all vulnerable. We say, I want a taste of reality. Come on, can you give me the taste? And the Shakti guru will say, "Oh yeah, I'll give you the taste." Boom, there you go. You got a taste of it, you know. That just fosters dependence on them, is what it does. Which is what they want in the first place. Because they want to be kings and queens of this world. They want to be rulers of existence. They want to be prime creators. They want you to be part of their kingdom. They want you to establish their kingdom here on earth. So, you know, all this establishing kingdom of heaven on earth, it's always establishing someone's kingdom of heaven, isn't it? It's not yours, is it? It's theirs. They say it's for you, but no, it never is it really? It's always a power hierarchy. Always. Yeah, and this stuff is easy for me to say because it's just little gentle baby steps. because it's clear, you know. You know, I'm treading into warm water, of course, you know. I realize that these are things that are not generally talked about here. But it's not like I'm making some big leap into this, you know. If I need to take one little gentle step back, of course I can. And we don't need to name names because it continues on. It will always continue on in existence. This will always be part and parcel of existence. These charismatic Shakti gurus will always arise in existence. They will always claim that they'll help you build the kingdom of heaven. And you'll be, you know, blissful here, etc. They're always only, they want you to serve them, their own egoic aggrandizement. And build a very comfortable, lush, luxurious place for them so they can indulge their every whim. That's what they really want. It's an egoic power trip, but that will always be taking place in existence. So it'll just change names. I mean, this dynamic will arise again and again and again. And if you're looking at it under the name of so-and-so, you'll miss it when it arises again because you say, well, that's a different name. That can't be the problem there. A different name. No. Forget about the names that this dynamic uses. It's always shifting names, shifting forms, shifting nationalities, shifting where it arises. Always where you don't think it's going to arise, then it arises there and says, oh, I got a new nationality, a new language, a new name. It's all different. This time it's good. And you get tricked again. So look at the dynamic of it. See the dynamic of it. So no matter when it arises, you won't be tricked again. No matter, you know, what frame it puts around it, the picture, you look at the picture, you'll say, aha, there's the picture. They want me to be a hare. They want to catapult me into reality. But that's not doing anyone any favors, really. Being catapulted into experience is not doing any favors at all. Because it then literally creates this massive insecurity, which can then be easily exploited. So I'm not saying anybody jump into experiencing problem-free. I'm saying clarify it first. Clarify it first, and only when it feels like a gentle baby step for you should you go into it. Don't leap. Take a gentle baby step. Do the work of clarification first. So you will not develop this extreme vulnerability complex by being catapulted into it. That's what I'm saying. Don't leap into it. I don't advise anyone to leap into it. And if there's this extremely rare instance where somebody can leap into it and stay, well, then they don't need to listen to me anyway. They won't listen to me anyway. They'll just leap. But other than that rare instance, the advice, don't leap into it, is great advice. Don't leap into it. Don't even try to leap into it. And I know there are those who say, yeah, you can just will it. Just will it to happen. Just use your will and just power into it. Not true. They're fostering dependence on themselves. They want to be some guru that fosters dependence on others. That fosters dependency on them. That's what they're actually aiming for. I'm saying don't leap into it. Don't even try to leap into it. Instead, turn around to the darkness and face it and see what you see there. See the defenses there. Take the time to do it. It takes time. It takes effort. But you're a workaholic anyway. So you'll be very happy to know the spiritual path is perfect for workaholics. Perfect. Because every day you realize, wow, I got a lot of work I got to do here. I got to turn around and face and clarify. And the work will be there for you. I've never been without the work, you know, working at this. Always going to take another baby step. Always. That's what I'm advising. In other words, make inquiry your career. It's not a 1 week thing. I mean, I know everybody wants to hope they can be catapulted into it, because why? Lazy. I remember when the Holy Spirit indicated to me, this is what you need to do. And I said, oh my gosh, And the Holy Spirit said, indicated, you know, well, what's your problem with this? You know, your only problem can be that you're lazy. And I heard that and I said, oh my gosh, that's right. I mean, I was aware of it. I didn't hear anything verbally. I was aware. I was seeing it. My only excuse was laziness, because I saw that what I had to do was going to take some time and some effort and some work. So what other excuse could I have is that I'm lazy. I don't want to do it. I've never gone to a spiritual retreat in my life, never. Because, I don't know, it's never worked out that way. What are spiritual retreats? Spiritual retreats are for people who say, you know what, I only got a little bit of time I can spend on the spiritual path, and I really want a taste of reality. I want a taste of it. I want to be catapulted into this. Generally speaking, that's there are also, I guess, retreats where those who are very close can really intensely focus on taking more and more baby steps. I mean, that's also very possible too. But there's also the thing of the belief that, you know what, I don't want to spend 20 years working on the path. I want to get it right now. I'm a hard charging, take charge person. I can get it. If I just have this retreat where we all focus and really push ourselves and insist that we got to do it and put peer pressure on each other and all the kind of stuff, we're going to go, whoom, we're going to be catapulted up and I'm going to get reality, get a taste of it. Well, maybe. Maybe they do have a peak experience. Then the rebound from that peak experience, that's where the problem comes in. And that's where they become dependent, again, on the teacher, the retreat leader, whatever. They end up fostering some desperate dependency on the teacher themselves as being greater than the experience of reality. And then they're willing to fork over their fortune, all their money to the teacher, et cetera, et cetera. Happens all the time. So retreats are something you have to be, you know, careful about. I mean, in a retreat, you know, I'm thinking, I've never held a retreat. If I held a retreat, I would be doing exactly what I'm doing right now, basically. Maybe we'd spend more time doing it. What the purpose of the retreat would be is just to help people prove to themselves that they can spend the time focusing on it. And so they come back from the retreat. The best that one can really get out of a retreat is to say, hey, you know what? I want to spend maybe at least 4 hours a day, and I can do it. I know I can do it, and I'm going to do that. Instead of 10 minutes, I'm going to spend 4 hours. I'm going to make every day a retreat. It gets the momentum going towards that. It's not that they come away and say, from a retreat and say, I got it. I'm enlightened. I'm self-realized. I got it. That's very unlikely to happen. You know, rarely that might happen, rarely. But it can happen just as easily on this, watching your computer, listening to this satsang just as easily. There's no difference. It only comes when you have the clarity, when you've yourself have tread the path and seen for yourself, and then realize it's only one little baby step to go, and realize you cannot take the belief in transformation with you, and that's okay. You're okay with that. Only then will you actually get it, because get it means there's no rebound. Because if there's a rebound, you didn't get it. You got the booby prize, you got severe insecurity, and you got a likelihood you're going to get into a guru trip of worshiping a guru and forking over all your energy to them, your time, effort, money, and energy to them. Being trapped in this codependency thing with some guru who themselves went on a rebound situation and have figured some way to try and stabilize themselves. They say, hey, if I can get, you know, thousands of people to worship me, I don't even have to go back into reality. I can just claim that I am reality. I can be the, you know, the king or the queen of my own reality, because I got all these people worship me and taking care of me. So that's their way of dealing with the rebound effect. They somehow were catapulted into that. Oftentimes these charismatic Shakti gurus, they end up fostering these more fake gurus, because these fake gurus themselves are trying desperately to find some way to cope with their insecurity they feel from their own rebound. And occasionally, if they have the right salesmanship approach, like right slick approach, and they're able to present themselves as, say, hey, I am the new guru. I'm the new improved better guru. I'm even greater than all the other gurus. You know, they're able to do that. And of course, they have to say that they're greater than the other ones. That's part of it. So, definitely don't want it. In a lot of ways, this is an intensive here. I mean, you're going a couple hours at a time. That's intensive. You're already having the intensive. If you're doing like 2 hours at a time, that is an intensive. And if you're like doing it twice a day, like 4 hours, that's super intensive. So leading a retreat is simply spending more time at inquiry. So the people get used to that, realizing, hey, I can do it. I didn't fall to pieces. I had this terror, like if I went more than, you know, 2 hours, I would be catapulted into reality. And, you know, it's funny because people go to intensives and they come back and they're kind of bummed out because they say, you know, I didn't get it. I didn't get catapulted into reality. And I think, ah, it didn't work. A waste of time. But then something inside them is very relieved. They say, whew. Wow, I'm so happy I didn't get it. Really, I was scared. If I went past the 2 hour mark, I thought I was going to get it, and I was terrified of that. But I went 4 hours and I didn't get it, and I was very relieved. I actually, this whole act about not getting it is for the guru's sake. They're saying, oh, guru, I feel so terrible. I didn't get it. I came to your intensive. I didn't get it. You know. But inside, they're saying, thank God. Oh my gosh, I'm not ready. I'm not ready. I'm not ready. I'm so relieved I didn't get it. The guru is disappointed. Said, you didn't get it. You came to my week intensive and you didn't get it. Oh boy, I'm so sorry to hear that. You know, it's awful. But you know, both of them are relieved probably. the gurus don't want to lose their devotees. You know, they don't want the devotee to get it, and the devotee doesn't want to get it either. So they're both relieved, but they play the charade of how disappointed they are in one another. You know. The devotee says, oh, guru, your power wasn't enough for me to get it. And the guru says, oh, your faith in me wasn't enough for you to leap. You know, you didn't get it. We're so disappointed in each other. And secretly, they have a big sigh, like, oh, my gosh, we're so glad, you know, they didn't get it. That's what's going on. It's pretty funny. And then in the genuine retreats, it's like, you're not expected to get it. Nobody's expecting you to get it. You're only going to get it when you realize you're willing to let go of that transformation, the belief in transformation slip through your fingers. Only then will you get it. And getting it means abiding in it. Ramana Maharshi didn't say leap into truth. He said abide in the self. The goal is to abide in the self. That's getting it. No rebound. No rebound. You don't jump in and jump out. You don't jump in and say, ah, the water is great. And then you say, yeah, jump out. It's too hot. I remember I used to live in Japan. I would go into these hot baths, which were where you literally slip down into the bath and up to your neck. And it was like incredibly hot. And I tried to get in carefully, and the Japanese say, no, here's how you do it. You jump in, you just whoosh, all at once, and then don't move. What happens is when you do that, there's like a layer of air still around your body, that your body has this thin layer of air, and it insulates you from the heat. And if you just don't move at all, you don't really feel the heat, but gradually you start feeling the heat, and then you realize, oh my gosh, this is scalding hot. But if you try going bit by bit, you feel the scalding hotness and you can't get in at all. So they just say, get in all at once. But reality is not scalding hot. So. But we have this idea, you know, we do need to jump into it because it's scalding hot. And if we don't just leap into it, you know, we'll never be able to get into it. We just got to jump head first. Okay. Don't have to That's not the way. Of course, if we do that, we're going to not even consider the fact that we're carrying the belief in transformation with us. And as we start to feel it slip away from us, we're going to become terrified. And then we'll leap back out of it. And we'll go cling to the guru and say, "Guru, I'm so terrified. It terrified me beyond belief. You can't believe how bad it is." And the guru will shake their head. "I understand. I understand." Because they too experience the same thing. And they say, "Oh, you understand. Of course, of course. You know, don't worry. You just have faith in me and I will save you from that fear that you experienced now." Actually, it's codependency. Because the devotee is saving the guru from going back in, and the guru is saving the devotee from going back in, and so it's a codependency situation. Of course, it doesn't last because each becomes dissatisfied in the other. Because they're losing everything constantly. Existence is terrible, still suffering. They can only play this codependency game so long, and it breaks down. The guru dies, the devotees leave, and, you know, that's it. Devotees go look for another guru. Yeah, this is what I observe. I have observed all of this in the world. I just came here. I just observed. You know, just observed everything's going on. What are the problems here? Why does this world have so much problems? You know, on the spiritual path, because we're all frantically engaged in transformation. We're trying to transform the world. You know, I tried to transform this house, this garden, yard, of course, you know, because if you don't, you stick out like a sore thumb. So now I have this, you know, beautiful garden here and yard and everything looks fabulous. And people walk by and they say, "Oh, look at this. Wow. This guy really works hard on transforming things." But, you know, once I did it, put the facade up, you know, now I can spend time doing this. So it is necessary usually to have some facade in this world. So those who are on the spiritual path have to work twice as hard, really. You know, keep up some minimal facade. You don't want people thinking that you're not helping them transform the world, because then they'll hate you, you know. You'll feel ostracized. It's very difficult. You have to at least seem like you're in with the idea of transforming the world. Otherwise, you know, wow, it's tough right now. It's not like there's a whole bunch of spiritual traditions that are completely free of the notion of transformation. It's not that way anymore. It used to be, you know, there were some traditions, some real good religious spiritual traditions that just said, "Hey, you know, live the monastic life. Don't try to transform the world. That's perfectly okay." Nowadays, it's not okay anymore. The religion of the world is transformation. And so if you don't at least have some facade, you may seem to be too weird to everybody. You know, wow, why aren't they working on transforming things? They must be insane. They must be crazy. They need medication. Really. They need psychotherapy. They need to regain their motivation. You know, somehow they lost it. They lack self-esteem. All these things like that. So, you know, put up a facade. Put up a facade of the successful person who's out to transform the world. But make sure that putting up this facade is done. Actually, God's grace will help you do it. Because it's necessary. So it doesn't use all your time and energy. You know, doing the work I did almost wiped me out. I almost died from it. I was just completely so tired. So difficult to do. But I got it done. I knew I had to get it done a certain time, and now I'm available to do this, and I have this beautiful facade out here, and people see it and say, "Holy cow, this guy's really so good at transforming things. What an expert, you know, is." Meets approval, you know, stamp of approval, stamp of neighborhood approval. Wherever your neighborhood, wherever you happen to be, you have to fit in with whatever, you know, seemingly efforts they're making to transform the world. You don't want to stick out like a sore thumb and people scapegoat you and say, "The reason why we're not succeeding is this one over here is not doing their part." You know, they're lollygagging, they're slacking, this terrible slacker over here. In fact, they don't even believe in it. Wow, they're crazy. How do they expect us to succeed if we don't transform the world? They're asking us to just suffer for endlessly. We gotta transform this suffering. So they gotta keep working. Come on. Get going. That's why sometimes those who are true teachers come into really powerful, wealthy families, like the Buddha came into a, you know, the rulers of a kingdom, you know, because that gives them slack. I mean, they have so much, people look to them and say, oh, these people are the actual paragons of working to transform the world. So anyone who belongs to this lineage, you know, must be that way too. So the Buddha could spend all the time in inquiry and wouldn't get much grief from it. People could say, this is Lord so-and-so. And Lord so-and-so, there, you know, it comes from this long lineage of great transformers of the world. And so they bought him a lot of slack. And sometimes those who become great true teachers like me have a lot of wealth in the family. And so they're able to look the part of a transformer of the world, a mover and a shaker of the world. And people cut him a lot of slack. And so they're able to go on retreat. They say, what are they doing? Oh, he's on like a 2-year retreat to Nepal, and they're doing a meditation with the master there. And someone say, oh, okay, that's great. As long as they have the Lamborghinis and Ferraris, you know, in the garage, you know, they say, oh, okay, they take a couple of years off to meditate. Shouldn't be a problem. They'll be able to get right back in the swing of things. So not all the wealthy people are what they seem to be. Some of them are just using that as a facade of success so they can actually spend their time in true inquiry. For instance, for me, when I really was turning things around and establishing the path of inquiry so that it was irreversible, and really seeing through the whole belief in transformation, when I was really doing the heavy work on that, it was so frightening. I didn't want anybody to realize what I was doing. It was scary, because you say, oh my gosh, this whole path of transformation, that belief is the problem, and that is the religion of the world. And especially where I live, you know, that is what everybody's doing. Silicon Valley. I mean, I've lived here my whole life, and of course the digital revolution took place here. The entire massive push to transform the world started here and is still rooted here. And so here I am saying transformation is the great obstacle to liberation, the belief in transformation. And I saw it and I said, oh my gosh, I don't want anybody to know what I'm seeing clearly. So I literally spent a lot of my time trying to appear to be the most successful person in the world, the most gung-ho, you know, the leader of transformation of the world, trying to present a facade so nobody would question me what I'm thinking or believing. They'd all look at me and say, oh my gosh, here's a CEO of some tech company here, you know. Definitely the last thing in the world he could possibly be doing is inquiring into transformation and seeing that this is the great obstacle. But I was like paranoid about it. I said, I don't want anybody to think that I'm on the spiritual path at all. So I was wearing, like, you know, super expensive suits and custom tailored clothing, and I dressed like I was like a king, you know, really, like I was a billionaire. People looked at me and thought I was probably a billionaire, because I didn't want them to see that I was totally seeing through this whole belief in transformation was totally bogus. And I didn't want anybody to even think that I was seeing that, because I could have really been pressured and ostracized severely. Could have led to a lot of trouble. They probably would have said, gee, you need to go see this, you know, codependent guru there and worship them, because if you're interested in spirituality, that's what you need. In other words, you need to maintain your belief in transformation. If they thought I was on the spiritual path, they probably would have pushed me in that direction. I experienced some of that. So I really put on a facade of a billionaire. Only problem was I didn't have the car to match. So couldn't do it completely, but enough extent was out in public, so I didn't feel any inquiry, any interest in me whatsoever. Like, hey, is that person on the spiritual path? No way. No thought of that whatsoever. So sometimes in this world, we do need to put on facades of disguise, disguising the fact that we're seeing through the whole charade here. Because this charade doesn't want to be seen through. This charade defends being seen through. And if we're feeling really insecure, we might say, gee, I need to go see one of those fake gurus who everyone will say, oh, okay, they're seeing that crazy guru and they have a codependency with them. They'll say, well, okay, because they know that's not really going to see through the facade. Oh, you're just wasting your time doing that, playing a game. And so you get even pushed into that. I almost got pushed into it. But then by adopting this facade, non-spiritual facade of like some super successful, someone who's completely focused on transforming the world, by adopting that facade, I didn't feel any need to go hide with one of these fake gurus, you know, that use that as a crutch. Didn't need to. Don't give up your facade. Don't give it up. I'm not asking anyone to give up their facade, whatever they're using, that disguises their interest in truth. Keep it. Very important to keep it. Whatever the facade is, you know, if it's a facade of being a mover and a shaker, you know, keep that facade. At the same time, get into inquiry. Because then your inquiry will be able to go really very, very smoothly, very powerfully. Because then you'll be able to discover the truth. You'll be able to see through the delusion of existence. See through, look at your defenses, realize, I don't need transformation. I don't need to believe in it anymore. And yet you'll still have this facade that you do believe in it, and other people will not attack you, you know. They won't feel that you're threatening them. Because people feel if they lose the belief in transformation, they're going to be completely attacked. They're terrified of that. So you don't want to push it in their faces by saying, hey, everybody, I'm some great spiritual aspirant devotee, and I'm going to see through all your delusions, and I'm going to tell you what they are, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, no, people hate that. They really hate that. Terrifies them. Instead, it's better to say, I'm 100% believing in the power of transformation, believing in magic and transformation, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, that's where I'm at. Just look the part. You don't say it, but you just, you know, look the part, and then nobody bothers you. And then you can spend your time really doing the real work that's necessary. A lot of people look like have been businessmen, you know, et cetera. In history, you look at who's really awake, and a lot of these people are like businessmen and civil servants and tax collectors and, you know, like Jesus' devotees, you know, a tax collector, for goodness sakes, carpenter, various things, you know, they're busy transforming the world or whatever. They had their facades. He said, keep these facades, you know. Well, he did say that rich person, you know, get rid of all and follow me. But what he was saying was, drop the attitudes of a rich person. In other words, stop trying to copyright everything and package everything and claim exclusivity of distributorship and all these things that merchants need to do to get rich. You can't bring those into the kingdom, because kingdom, everyone has everything there. So you'll feel like you're somehow being impoverished because you can't have more than somebody else. So he's saying drop those attitudes. He didn't mean drop the facade of being a rich person. No, because that facade can be very useful. You'll get slack. The rich person will say, I need to scale back what I'm doing and turn it over to my, you know, offspring and heirs, and I need to kind of take some quiet time for all the stress I've been under. I want to spend the next 10 years, in reflection. Reflection. Autobiography. Maybe I'll write my autobiography, and everyone says, oh, great, great, great. Yeah, that's fine. Okay, go ahead, go for it. And then what they really do is they spend the next 10 years in inquiry, next 20 years in inquiry, and maybe one day they step into the living light and no rebound, you see? Yeah, people from all walks of life actually do it. You don't have to change your facade at all. Maybe being like being a real poor, powerless person is also a facade, right? Because you say, nobody can expect me to transform the world, and nobody's expecting it from me. So then again, you can spend all your time in inquiry, and nobody's going to question you, because they say, oh, this person, he's a nobody, nothing. You know, I don't expect anything from him anyway. So that's also a facade. You might be a super, super wise and person, and be very poor, and have nothing, and have no influence in the world whatsoever. And that's actually a blessing. It's a facade you can use, because nobody expects anything from you. You don't have to deliver anything. You don't have to pretend to be successful. You don't have to transform the world in any way, because everyone says, ah, this person, stupid, nobody, don't expect anything from them. Next. And so you can spend all your time in inquiry that way. So that can be a great blessing. Being really born into poverty and obscurity can be the highest blessing here in this world. Nobody expects a thing from you. Now they expect you to, you know, to go along with whatever orders you're given, but you might, you can appear to be such a simpleton, you can't even do that. Ananda, my ma, was born into a little, tiny little village out in the boondocks of what's now Bangladesh. No expectations of her to be successful in any way. No expectations of schooling or anything. Reading, writing, arithmetic, accomplishments, no. Just simply to do the rituals, the devotional rituals to their, you know, what they worship, the family worship, and there were no expectations, great expectations at all. And she was this incredible simpleton. So, extreme poverty, living way out in the boondocks, country hick, you know, and herself being this incredible simpleton. Nobody expected anything of her. They always thought, oh my gosh, what is this? What is she going to do? How is she going to survive? She's got no skill, no talent. She's such a simpleton. They say, well, you know, maybe we'll find her a good husband, good, responsible husband, and he'll take care of her, you know, which is what they did. Even Bolanath, you know, he was a very responsible person, policeman at that time. And, well, he worked for, the railway office, and then became a policeman, and responsible type of guy. And they said, whew, okay, this poor Nandamayama, she's such a simpleton, knows nothing about the world, so naive, etc. They expected nothing of her. And so she would sit there quietly every day. You know, at times she'd just sit there when she wasn't housekeeping, and just, you know, like in a trance. Or, you know, and they'd say, wow. They shrug their shoulders and say, oh, well, what do you expect? She's kind of a little, you know, mentally unbalanced. She's got mental problems. Because she didn't cry when she was born. She was just completely still. And they thought, uh-oh, that's not normal. There's something developmentally wrong with her. So they didn't expect anything of her. And so she spent her time absorbed in reality. And with zero interest in transformation. Nobody questioned her, really. Eventually, when she started her work to reach out to the world, then people started questioning her, like, you're kind of weird, you know, what are you doing? But by and large, being the simpleton, playing the fool, being the simpleton, being the country hick, etc., was extremely advantageous to her. I thought someone was sawing something. It was actually the breeze hit this banana plant here. And this banana plant is up in the rafters, and it was causing the dead part of the banana plant to go back and forth, back and forth, back, and it caused like a sawing sound. It sounded exactly like somebody sawing a branch. So I said, who's sawing a branch? I'm looking around. It's just a leaf of a banana plant. That's like being on the path and thinking you see a snake, and you find out it's just a rope, you know, or a stick. Because our senses can, you know, frighten us like that. That was very frightening, because I thought someone was right here sawing a branch, and I couldn't see him. I said, "Where? Who's sawing a branch?" Wow. It's amazing. In reality, in the vision of Christ, the vision of the real world, it's not being seen by our senses. It's being seen directly through awareness. And so there's no possibility of misinterpreting something like that. So there's no possibility of fear. Everything is seen completely clearly, exactly what it is. Exactly where it is, exactly as it is. But our senses here in this world can scare the heck out of us. It happens all the time. We hear a sound, you say, oh, it's the boogeyman, you know. What is that? A crash, you know. Oh, no, you know. Something terrible has happened. So don't drop your facade, whatever your facade is, whatever's working for you that makes you feel like people are not going to pry into your inquiry and see, what do you really believe? Are you really shedding your belief in transformation? Keep that facade. Keep it up. Keep it going. It's very helpful. Supremely helpful. Really. If I didn't have that facade, I couldn't have made it, you know, because my inquiry was so profound. I realized, oh my gosh, I am really getting the job done here. This is serious business, and the world is not going to like this. Especially the spiritual teachers are not going to like this, which is why I've always been shielded from spiritual teachers. Because most spiritual teachers on the planet are this codependency thing. Not all of them, and some to a greater or lesser degree. But I was always shielded from teachers, really. No matter what I did, I could never meet up with any teacher. They'd always have just left town. I'd find out about it. Oh, they were just here. Doggone it. If they were here, if I'd have known they were here, I would have gone and seen them. And somehow I never am aware of when the teachers are in here. Because most of them are really in that whole codependency transformational trick thing of delay. You know, come to my intensive, come see me. You'll be enlightened just by the contact. How you get from me will enlighten you immediately. Just come spend, you know, $75 for a ticket, and you'll get it. I say, devote your entire life towards inquiry, and be a workaholic at it, and someday you will see very, very clearly exactly what needs to be done. And to you, it will only be a little baby step at that point, and you realize there won't be any rebound. That's what I'm saying. Be a workaholic. And disguise your workaholicism. Disguise it. Don't let the world know you're a workaholic. Whatever disguise works, disguise the fact that you're a workaholic on the spiritual path. Don't let anyone know. I never told anybody what I was doing. I studied A Course in Miracles for 15 years, and the entire time I studied it, I only mentioned it to one person, just in passing, kind of like, there's this book out called A Course in Miracles, and I was looking at it, and I say it's pretty good teaching. I said it one time to one person. I never, ever told a single other soul that I was spending all my time, you know, 14, 16 hours a day on this. And at the time I was so ill that I was just in my room, sitting in my room, so nobody expected anything of me. So I literally spent 16 hours a day or more sometimes, you know. Only wasn't sleeping very well, so I just keep studying it. For years and years, I never told anybody, never told a soul. Never told anybody I'm on a spiritual path. Never. Stayed away from that like the plague, you know. So now, even now, I'm only saying it on through these videos. I'm not going around telling my co-workers or relatives or anything that I'm on a spiritual path. I'm not saying a word of it. No, I'm out to transform the world, you know. Look what I've done with my yard. Oh, you've transformed everything. How wonderful. I'm not telling anybody. Why court problems? You don't need to tell anybody. They're not gonna like it anyway. I think you're crazy. They say, well, at least if you're still working hard to transform the world, then okay, that's fine. But the problem is, they'll think if you're on a spiritual path, they expect you to be much more adept at transforming the world. So they'll say, you're on a path, really? Well, how does this help you transform the world? That's what they'll ask you. And how has it increased your ability to transform the world? And then you have to say, and you have to make something up. And they'll look at you carefully and they'll say, wait, I think this person's a fake, a phony, they're lying, because they haven't become better at transforming the world. In fact, they're not doing as well. So they're on a spiritual path? Nah, they're lying. And the people will actually dislike you because they think you're a phony. If you say you're some power devotee on the spiritual path to make a lot of progress, then they'll say, okay, I expect you to be building hospitals and housing and feeding the homeless and making scientific discoveries and transforming the world. I don't see you doing that at all. In fact, you spend most of your time sitting still on a bench somewhere. You must be the biggest phony in the world. And they'll really hate you for it. They literally think that you are a severe phony, and people hate phonies. So it's far better to say, I'm really ineffective transforming the world because I'm not very smart, and I'm not very capable, and I'm really kind of a simpleton, and I'm doing my best, you know, and I look like I planted some flowers and stuff, but gee golly, that's about all I can do. And they'll say, this somebody's nothing. Don't tell them you're some heavyweight on the spiritual path, because there'll be hell to pay if you do. Because they'll say, show me the beef. Where is your transformation? What have you done? And you can't point to anything. And they'll say, wow, what a liar and a braggart and a deceiver you are to say you're on a spiritual path, and yet your capability to transform the world hasn't been augmented at all. Wow, you're horrible. You're the worst person in the world. And they'll really feel that way. They'll hate you. I mean, they won't just be joking. I mean, they'll really have absolute scorn towards you. Which is why I say, never, never say you're some spiritual heavyweight unless, you know, you really have the guidance that you're very close. And you're not going to be, you know, swayed by all that. Really, if anyone came here and said, Clarity Ross is like gives very, very good satsang, very helpful, people would look at you like you're crazy. So what are you talking about? This idiot? I mean, what does he know? He doesn't know anything about spiritual truth. How could he know anything? He's not been on any spiritual path. He's not some mover and shaker and transformer of bringing good into the world and positive change. What are you talking about? He must be nuts. He must be some crazy sycophant or something. You must be part of a cult. That's what they'll drop. They always drop that one. You must be part of a cult. But I don't see. You two are crazy. I don't see them. He can't possibly be effective satsang, and you can't. You must be a bogus devotee because of that. And how are you? Why don't you both go out and go visit, you know, people in rest homes, and do something good with your life. That is literally what would you get. See? Pretty amazing, isn't it? And then if you're intimidated by that, what happens is you will go out and start visiting people in restaurants. As I did. You literally will start volunteering, you know, doing stuff as I did. In other words, trying to fit their idea, their notion of what someone on the spiritual path should be doing, should be transforming the world, is what they believe in. So it's far, far better to play the fool. And even if you're on the spiritual path, people know it, you can just say, you know what? I'm really not very good at this. I need to work hard at it because I'm really very, very slow study here. Very slow study. So why are you spending so much time looking at these, listening to these satsangs? Well, you know, I'm really very, very difficult for me. I feel like I'm really, you know, kind of low person on the totem pole here. I don't think I got what it takes to just jump into reality. You know, I'm one of these real people, are really back of the pack kind of people, you know. That's why I'm spending all this time. And then people might say, okay. But whatever you do, don't claim to be some kind of superstar. back of the pack. Because if you're a superstar, they'll say, well, why don't you just leap right into it? You don't need to spend more than 10 minutes at it. See, so say, you know, I'm kind of slow. I'm not really good at this. This is new to me. And, you know, I feel it's very important, but I'm kind of a slow poke, and I need this kind of teaching because I'm such a slow poke. You know, you play the pity card. You know, pity poor me. I'm really a dullard. But, you know, a dullard's got to get some help too, you know. See, that's the problem. In fact, I was so bright and so smart and such a workaholic, etc., that people saw me and they said, oh my gosh, you're a superstar. And then they expected me to transform the world, which caused me the most incredible problems. So I literally had to remake myself and go into hiding and pretend to be an idiot just so I could get them off my back. But you see, I wasn't stupid at all. I was super smart. I was smart enough to know how to use smartness in the proper way, which is being super smart. But people saw how smart he was, and they said, oh my gosh, this guy can be a world leader, you know? And they started pushing me in that direction, taking on all this responsibility. You need to do this and this and this and this and this. You need to get into Stanford. You need to get a PhD from Stanford. And then you need to climb up the ladder of in academia. And one day you're going to be maybe president or something like that. That's literally, I had all that placed on me. And I said, oh my gosh, I will completely fail in my responsibility here if I do that. And I, you know, fell completely sick because I had too much stress and conflict. I can't do them both. And then eventually I fell down into being absolutely nobody, where then I could really apply my intelligence to inquiry. So it's a terrifying thing in this world if you appear to be real smart. I mean, Ramana Maharshi didn't appear to be smart to anybody. In fact, he was basically just kind of an athletic type of guy, but he didn't seem to be excel in class at all. They said, what's he going to be? Maybe he's going to be a soccer player, they thought. Really, I don't know if any of you know that, but Ramana was quite an athlete. He was very good at playing games like soccer and various athletic games. And then the other thing he was good at was sleeping. He was an extremely deep sleeper. Nobody could wake him up when he was sleeping. Nobody could wake him up. They could carry him around town in a rickshaw or whatever, and he wouldn't wake up. he was like carrying a dead person around. But he didn't show any intellectual promise. Nobody looked at Ramana and said, you know what, wow, you could be the minister or premier, or you could be a leader of India someday, you know, you could be a governor, you could be someone great, you could really transform the world. Nobody looked at him that way. And so one day he just woke up and said, and left home, and disappeared, and went and lived some cave somewhere up on Arunachala. Nobody expected anything. But people said, oh, there's some crazy guy up there in a cave starving himself. You know, nobody said expected anything. And then he, you know, eventually came out of the cave and he was abiding in the self perfectly. If the world sees you as some superstar, then you've got a horrendous burden on yourself. And the problem with me, like in music, I could play music so well at an early age. You know, I literally heard symphonies in my mind. I could, at any moment, I could literally imagine glorious symphonies in my mind. You know, and I say, oh, I got to figure, and then people, and I was trying to like figure out how can I compose these symphonies. And I worked on music and people said, oh my gosh, this guy could be a virtuoso. You know, I got this fire and total confidence in music. I had this supreme confidence, and they said, you can be some great virtuoso musician, and you can help transform the world, right? You can provide the soundtrack to transformation, is what they said. So I had both of those things. Academically, I was so bright, and artistically, I was so capable and confident. They said, you know, you can do it all. You can be president. You can be a super musician, superstar, and you can do all this stuff, and you can transform the world. We expect that you're going to do this. And I had all these successful people come to me and, you know, you know, almost bow to me and say, wow, we're so great, nice to meet you. We realize your potential, your human potential is so extreme. You're going to be this great person. I had people say that. You're going to be this great, great being here on this planet. You're going to be part of this great transformation that's coming. So all of that was put on me, and then I fell supremely ill. That's what happened. And I fell off their radar screen. And so basically, nobody then ever came to me and said, you're going to ever do anything. Now they all come to me and say, you're never going to do anything. So I went from you're going to be a world beater to you're a complete loser. So pretty amazing stuff. Keep your facade. Don't let anybody know you're a superstar. And be a workaholic. And someday you literally will see that the all you need to do is take a little baby step, and you will be abiding in the problem-free world, living light, the self, no rebound, and you will be the same as Ramana or anyone else that's done it. All right, for this video, it's been great sharing this time with you. That's it for this video.